director of the Center for International Higher Education at Boston College in the United States. Originally, I'm from the Netherlands. I work in the United States since 1.5 years. And my specialization is talking about internationalization of higher education around the world. So how universities around the world are trying to internationalize themselves and what are the challenges and opportunities. We call it also global engagement, but I prefer myself to use more internationalization. The center I am directing, as a brief introduction, and is not a typically American higher education center. Most of the centers in higher education studies around the world focus very much on what is higher education in the American context, or in the German context, or in the Russian context. In our center, we focus very much on what is happening all over the world, and in particular putting also a lot of attention to what is happening in countries that are generally not seen as being important in higher education. What is happening in Asia, what is happening in Africa, what is happening in Latin America and Central Asia. We try to understand that very well and to have scholars from all over the world work with us in understanding what is happening in higher education. Why is higher education so important in the world? Higher education has always been there, and I come back to that in my talk, but increasingly now, in the current global society we live in, higher education has become very important because knowledge is a global knowledge, and you have to understand what higher education can do to make the world better, but also how higher education increasingly is becoming a commodity and a commercial product, and what are the challenges and opportunities related to that. So we do research on that for organizations like the World Bank, the American Council of Education, but also the European Parliament and the European Commission. And we work, for instance, very much also with Russian universities in the 500 project, of which RUDN is one of the members, to make them understand how you can operate and compete and cooperate in this whole international higher education world that we're in. So I'm going to say a little bit about that in my talk. Feel free to ask questions during my talk or to comment on what I'm saying. I'm talking about a little bit what are global trends in internationalization of higher education. What then about internationalization, rankings and accreditation processes? What do we mean with internationalization as a concept and approach? And what are the challenges and opportunities for that as the end? So that are more or less the four topics. I do that in a university in RUDN, which is one of the few universities around the world who has for a long time always been very international. You have had already in the time of the Soviet Union, you had a very international student composition, you had a very strong international approach, but you were one of the few institutions around the world in that time that were doing that. And it was part of the struggle between the superpowers, in particular the Soviet Union at that time and the United States, to have a contact with the rest of the world and to make allies in the rest of the world. So this university was a clear example of that Cold War period to attract students from different parts of the world to understand how the Soviet system was working. And of course, American universities did the same. The rest of the world was not so much engaged, but you had this competition for students already for much more political reasons, where now you see you compete much more for international students, international scholars, for economic reasons and for reputation and branding and commercial objectives. But so it is interesting to see how a context is very important. When we talk about internationalization of higher education, that's always made reference to the fact that universities around the world have always been international. They say, well, the word university already means universe, the whole world. And to a certain extent, that was true for the Middle Ages and the Renaissance period in Europe, when universities were very small. There were very few universities in the whole of Europe. And in the highlight of the Renaissance period, there were only 72 universities all over Europe. And so students and scholars had to move from one country to the other to study. They couldn't stay on one place, so they had to go from Paris to Bologna, from Bologna to Coimbra, from Coimbra to Oxford and Cambridge to teach and to learn. And the wandering scholar, the Dutch philosopher Erasmus, was a clear example of how in that time you would have to go from one country to the other to study. And so one of the biggest programs of student mobility around the world, the Erasmus program, is called after that Dutch philosopher, expressing how much we try again to create a kind of European higher education area. There was also something in common what you see now as a trend. There was one language of communication in all those universities. Around that time it was Latin, and now increasingly you see that English is the language of communication in higher education. In research, in peer-reviewed articles, in journals, in books, mainly the main language of communication has become English. And so there is some parallel, but at the same time the context of course is quite more different, because now there are hundred thousands of nobody knows exactly how many universities are around the world, but there are probably some between 50,000 and 100,000 universities around the world. In China, still every week they have created one university. So it is much broader, it's much more global, but universities have been international. But at the same time, most of the universities that have been created in the 18th and the 19th century didn't have an international exposure. They were basically built to create a labor force and a talented for national construction and national nation building. So the international dimension was for a long time in most universities not present. And it's only in the past century, in particular after the Second World War and during the Cold War period, and on that increasingly universities had to become more international. And that international dimension took many different shapes in research, research collaboration, publications, but also in teaching, mobility of students for full degree programs, mobility for short-term study abroad experience of a semester, mobility of scholars, and even now, increasingly, and come back to that, also mobility of institutions, mobility of programs, and increasing commercial operations. We have now branch campuses of universities from the United States or Australia or the UK or France and Germany, etc., in other countries around the world. We have franchise operations, we know franchises from McDonald's and Starbucks and other companies, but you also have franchise operations of universities increasingly, where they franchise their programs in another country around the world. So there's a lot of things happening under the umbrella of what we call internationalization of higher education. And it's driven by all kinds of factors, political motives, economic motives, social and cultural dimensions, and academic rationales. Universities can do it, be international because of economic gain. They want to make money out of the of internationalization. But two clear examples are countries like the UK and Australia, where international students are the second or the third export commodity of the country. So it is a very important contribution to the economy of those countries that they have international students, because international students not only pay high tuition fees, but they also have living expenses, they have travel expenses, and their parents come to visit them, etc. So it's a very important export commodity for those countries, and that drives very much the agenda of those countries. And the same you see happening in certain states in the United States, in Canada, you see it happening in institutions in Europe, and you see it happening increasingly elsewhere as well, that it is becoming an economic factor. But there are also political motivations to do that. I referred already to this university being in the Cold War, an example of how the government of the Soviet Union wanted to attract international students to understand what this socialism and communism meant here, and the same happened with governments in the, like in the United States, to attract international students, to bring them into the capitalist world. So there were also all kind of political motives. There are political motives in the sense of identity building, understanding what the culture of another country is, etc. So, then there are academic reasons to increase your reputation and branding and your quality by internationalizing. So there's a whole range of factors that define why universities increasingly are becoming more international. But its impact is different when you look at Latin America or Asia or Russia or the United States. And it is also different by type of institution. Because a research university or a world-class university like Harvard, Yale, they are having a completely different international focus than a small specialized institution or a liberal arts college or a university of applied sciences. So it is very contextual what means to be an internationalized university by country and by type of institution. So there's not one single model fits all, and we always have to look into the different contexts. But if you look at the global trends with respect to internationalization, and this is based on a study I was directing for the European Parliament 2 years ago with a group of experts. The European Parliament, which funds a lot of money for mobility of students, but also for joint research projects, etc., they wanted to know why the European Commission was giving so much money to all those programs, and to be able to play their role as a parliament to control the European Commission, they said, well, we want to have a study to understand what is happening with internationalization of higher education around the world. So we did a study around 17 countries in the world, and what we saw is that increasingly at all levels higher education becomes more and more internationalized. Governments find it very important. Many countries have now a national strategy for internationalization of higher education. They create all kinds of excellence programs. The 5100 program in Russia is a very clear example of the government saying, well, we want to be internationalized, we want to be in the top rankings of the world of universities, we want to have a strong reputation. So what we do, we invest in universities to increase their quality, to increase their reputation, to increase the number of rankings, and I come back to that. But similar programs you have in Germany, in Japan, in Canada, in France, everywhere they say, in China, they say, well, we want to internationalize because we see that we have to have a much more higher reputed international higher education system and institutions within them. So more strategic approach to internationalization than ever before is very high on the agenda of governments. Institutions as well, they also are increasingly becoming aware that they have to be international. They have to have more international students, they have to have more international scholars, but they also have to create graduates in their universities that are able to work and live in a much more global environment. So also to have their curriculum and their teaching and learning much more internationalized. What you see, and I come back to that later, is that at the same time, more and more governments and institutions copy themselves in their strategies. They say, oh, we have to be international, otherwise we lose our reputation, we lose in the competition. So what we do, we have to recruit more international students, we have to recruit more international scholars, and we have to teach in English. And everybody does the same thing. But if everybody does the same thing, you are competing with each other for a pool which is very limited. So you have to, again, identify the context more, how to do that. And what then happens if you have to be more international as universities, you have to need money, because you have to invest in that, because money can't come back with international students, as I said, who pay tuition fees and who pay living expenses, but first you have to invest. And what we see around the world, that investment in higher education by the public sector is decreasing. All over the world, including in Russia, the money that governments give to higher education is decreasing, and there's a higher demand to universities to find other sources of income. in particular, that is by tuition fees, so students have to pay more money to go to university, and the family has to pay more money, but also in research grants and in contracts with employers, etc. So there's a strong need to increase the external funding to be able to compete. If you look at the United States, where only something like between 10 and 20% of the funding comes from the government, and mainly from the state governments, not from the federal government. In continental Europe, it's something like 70%, and overall in the OECD, it is now 70%. In Russia, of course, it's still higher, but also it is in general decreasing. So what you see is increasing privatization of higher education, not only in the sense that the number of private universities is increasing around the world, more rapidly than public universities are increasing, but also in the sense that public universities increasingly have to privatize their sources. And so you see that we now have public universities, still mainly in Russia and in continental Europe. You have so-called not-for-profit private universities, for instance, from a religious background, Catholic universities, Islamic universities, Protestant universities, and you have increasingly also for-profit universities. And there are universities that are created by private companies, by multinationals increasingly, and you have big multinational companies like the Apollo Group and the Laureate Group in the United States that are on the stock market and buy up small universities all around the world to be making a profit out of higher education. So the trend for privatization is very strong. In a region like Latin America, over 50% of the universities are now private universities, and most of them are now for-profit universities. And that is, if you compare that to 20 years ago, that was far less. So given that there's still a high demand for higher education around the world, there are more students wanting to enter higher education than there is supply of higher education in many countries, Latin America, Africa, Asia in particular. You see a privatization happening because the state is doesn't have the funding to invest in higher education. So privatization is very strong, globalization is very strong, so you see an increasing competition at the global arena of higher education around the world. We compete for funding, we compete for students, we compete for the best scholars, we compete for research grants, we compete for entrance in peer-reviewed journals. Everything is competitive in that environment. So the trend is away from cooperation to competition. If you would look to universities in the 1980s, beginning of the 1990s, the whole emphasis was cooperation. We have to cooperate together. We have to exchange students, we have to exchange scholars, we have to do joint curriculum development, we have to do joint research cooperation. Now we compete. We compete for everything. And that's a whole shift in the higher education arena happening around the world. There's also a trend to regionalization. Regions say that they have to compete with other regions in the world. So in Europe, we have the European Union that has created all these programs for research cooperation and student exchange and faculty exchange to create a more competitive environment. We have also the Bologna process, and Russia is part of the Bologna process that was also as a purpose to make higher education in Europe much more transparent and coherent, and that we had the same kind of programs, bachelor, master and PhD, that we had a common credit system, the European ECTS system, so that students can easily move from one country to the other, from one institution to the other without having to do all things over again. So that kind of regionalization in Europe in the Bologna process has been a very strong example that you now see that also in ASEAN countries and the African Union in Latin America, they also say maybe we have to do something the same. We have to be harmonizing our structures of higher education to be much more competitive. But we also see a trend the numbers are still increasing. Currently, there are close to 5 million students that are not studying in their home country. They're studying in another country than their home country. That is already double when it was 10 years ago, and the predictions are that in 2025 it will be at least 8 million and most likely 10 million students not studying in their own country but doing a full bachelor, master or PhD degree outside their own country. So there's still a strong demand for higher education around the world, and although the most numbers of students come from Asia currently, China, India, Korea are the three main sending countries, and the most receiving countries are the United States, United Kingdom, Germany and France and Australia, that are the five most receiving countries. But also that pattern is changing. China, which is still the biggest sending country of students to the rest of the world, is also now the second after the United States of receiving international students. So they're also attracting international students to come to study with them. They attract them from Africa, they attract them from neighboring countries in Asia, and increasingly also from Russia, Europe, North America, from everywhere. And so we compete for students all over the world. That makes it quite more different than it was in the past. We see also that the faculty are increasing. We don't have exact figures of how many academics are moving from one country to another, but there's a lot of movement taking place there as well. There are more and more universities that are teaching in English because they want to have those international faculty, they want to have those international students, so they say, well, we have to teach in English to make it attractive to come to us. So that's also a trend that we see. And at the same time, we still have not enough data to understand exactly what is happening, but we see the trend is the numbers are increasing, and we have to make much more understanding of what is happening, and that's one of the roles that, for instance, my center does to do that. So if you look at what is happening in higher education, we see strategies for internationalization that tend to be still very much focused on mobility. Recruitment of students to go for full degrees abroad, but also to send students for a semester abroad or a year abroad as part of their home degree, the exchange of students. That number is still increasing. We see one hand countries that do it and institutions that do it for a short-term economic gain. They want to make money, like I gave the example of Australia and the UK, but still more and more institutions and countries that are trying to do that. But there are also countries who take a different position. Take, for instance, Germany. Germany doesn't have tuition fees, so education is for free. Not only for German students, but also for international students. So why are they still very much advocating that students come to study in Germany? And there are two main reasons. One is they think that after graduation, when the students return to their country, they will be the ambassadors for the economy and for the country abroad. So it will help them in the long term to benefit from the presence of those students in their country when they go home and they have a good experience and they say, well, if I want to set up a business, I'm going to do business with Germany. If I want to be a diplomat, I'm going to be in favor of Germany, etc. So that's long term gain. And that you see in Russia as well and see in many other countries as well. And the second reason increasingly is not so much the case in Russia, but you see it in countries like Japan, Canada, most continental Europe, and increasingly also Australia and the United States. We have a demographic factor which makes that students, the numbers of local students is decreasing. So if we need talents, we have to bring them from abroad. So it is very attractive to attract international students and not after they have graduated to go home, but to stay and give them permission to work in the knowledge economy. And in particular, you see that there's a whole competition for talents in the STEM field, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, because there is a shortage to foreseen in the economies for this kind of talents. So what they do, they recruit those students and they give them permission to stay after the studies and give them work permits and visa, which is quite different than it was 10 years ago. Then we didn't have that kind of urgency, but now we see, certainly in a country like Japan, for instance, which is a graying society, that there is a shortage of students from local sites, or they have to recruit them from elsewhere. And gradually you see that happening everywhere. We recruit talents, not only to study, but also to stay. So that's an important factor as well that you have to keep in mind when you talk about how international universities are. It is not a strong factor, as I said, yet in Russia, because there's no shortage of students in Russia. But it might happen that in the future something similar will happen here as well. And the last factor, and I'm going to talk a little bit more in detail about it further on, is increasingly internationalization is driven by rankings, reputation, national ranking, but in particular regional and international rankings, which define how good a university is. Because if you are high in the rankings, you receive more international students, you can become much more attractive for international scholars, you are high in the citation indexes for peer-reviewed academic journals, and also you are much more likely to get research funding from national and international sources. So rankings increasingly define it as well. As a consequence of that, what we see is that there's not really a comprehensive approach. Universities are copying each other, and we have to recruit international students, scholars, and publications. That's driving the agenda. But it is also important, and employers are advocating that, that local students become more international. And since not all local students have the possibility to go for a semester, a year abroad, or for a full study abroad, that means you have to internationalize your curriculum and your teaching and learning. You have to make your students much more globally competent or interculturally competent. So you have to make the curriculum much more clear, and I will give you a definition of that later. So if we talk about internationalization, and the same can say about global engagement, there are some misconceptions. What it is? We see an increase in that quantitative measures drive the agenda. More international students, more study abroad for a semester or a year, more co-publications, more courses in English, more partnerships. Universities now try to sign memorandums of understanding or agreements with universities all over the world. And I see many universities, and probably this one as well, that even have more agreements than they have students exchange or faculty exchange in those agreements. My own university has something like 500 agreements, and they only exchange something like 300 students. So there are at least 200 agreements that are obsolete. But they still sign them because they want to show up. So quantity is very much driving the agenda, where I think that quality is much more important as driving the agenda for internationalization. And it has to do with another misconception, is that internationalization is seen by governments and by institutions of higher education much more as a goal of itself. But that should not be the case. Internationalization has to be a means to enhance the quality of what we are doing, to enhance the quality of education, to enhance the quality of our research, and to enhance the service that universities have to pay to society. That has to drive the agenda for internationalization, not commercial objectives, not political objectives, but really quality criteria have to be very important. And in that, context is very essential. Contexts are essential, what happens externally, so what is the position of your institution or your country in the global and regional and the local context? What is the position internally in university? So what are the students, what are the faculty thinking, what are the disciplines in your institution? So if you have to have a strategy, you always have to ask yourself why we as a university are doing that. Only when you answer that question clearly in the context of an analysis of your position, you can say what are we doing and how are we doing it. And then you can define what your goals and objectives and outcomes are. But many institutions don't do that. So one of the roles of the expert board here in RUDN University is also that we help the university to make more explicit why this university wants to be a research university that is an international university at the same time. So why are you doing that? What makes you specific at this university compared to Higher School of Economics or the Moscow Lomonosov State University? What makes your university specific? And of course, this university has a historical specific context of really being international. It has 25% of the student body in this university is international, which is in the global context very much. There are not many universities that can say we have 25% international students in our university. And the objective that the university wants to go to is to 40%. So really becoming an international university even more. But why are you doing that? And then the question how is very important. So that was a little bit about context. Are there any questions or commentary so fast from you on what I've been saying? Nobody? All clear? Yeah? Very good. Then let's go to rankings. Rankings, I don't know how much you are aware about rankings, but there are three generally recognized international rankings of universities. One is the so-called Chiao Tong University rankings in China. The second one is Times Higher Education rankings of Times Higher Education is in a magazine in the UK. Which publish every year rankings, and then you have the QS rankings, which is a company that also publish every year a ranking of universities around the world. And each of them has a different accent. The Chiao Tong rankings is very much focused on research. For instance, the number of Nobel Prize winners, the number of research programs, the number of co-publications cited by international authors are very important. Times Higher Education tries to be a mixture of research and education, and QS is very much focused on reputation. So what do academics and what do employers find important in higher education based on their opinions that they rank the universities? QS, although very popular, for instance, in Russia and in Latin America, is considered by the expert as being the less qualitative of the three rankings. There are many other rankings, by the way. There are regional rankings, there are European rankings, like the EU multi-rank rankings, and so on. But these are the three most important rankings that there are. The problem is they only focus on the top universities. But there is not something like the university. There are a lot of different types of universities around the world, so-called world-class universities, which are mainly the universities in the top 200 of the rankings. You have national flagship universities, so universities that are very important in one country as a national university. You see that a lot in developing countries. You have research universities, which are not world-class universities. You have specialized universities, you have liberal arts colleges, professional schools, etc. So you have a lot of universities. In general, rankings only look at the top ones. But a good higher education system has a whole diversified system of different types of universities. You cannot have as a country only top research universities. You can also not have as a country only teaching institutions. You have to have a mixture of different types of universities to be effective. But that's very important. And that means that the notion of what is quality has to be embedded in the type of institution that you are and your role in that society. So quality means something completely different for a world-class university than for a small local institution or a liberal arts college or a professional school. But rankings only measure the world-class universities, and for that are very important. So what the problem is when you rank is that you don't rank the quality, but you rank the quantity. And the quantity then becomes an indicator of what is supposed to be your qualitative position. they should not, though, direct the quality, because the quality you can only develop as an institution. And so what happens that rankings basically put their indicators as a measure of quality, instead of the other way, that the quality that the institutions define defines the position in the rankings. And that's a very dangerous development, and that's what we see all around the world happening, that it is based on their indicators. And so an effort, for instance, like the 5100 project here in Russia, to have five universities in 2020 in the top 100 rankings of the world, is very difficult. Because then you have to adapt yourself to their criteria. And you also have to compete with those who are already in the top 100 or the top 200. And that's very difficult, because if you are already high in the top rankings, you have advantages to those who are not in the top. Because as you're high in the top rankings, you get more chance for funding. You get more chance to recruit top scholars. You get more chance to be cited in publications internationally. So that makes the whole way of trying to move up in the rankings very difficult. And if you see the rankings, then you see that there is little movement going up. Last week, Times Higher Education published its rankings, and it was a big surprise, because Oxford, for the first time, was the number one in the Times Higher Education ranking, where before it was always an American university, either Harvard or Caltech or MIT. Now Oxford was the first. But basically, Oxford was always number two or number three or number four. And the difference between the top 10 or even the top 50 is very low. So it doesn't make much difference. What is much more interesting is which new universities come into the top 50 or the top 100 or the top 200. And what you see, that there is very little movement they are coming into. Only from Asia, you see a gradual increase of position in the rankings. You see more Chinese universities coming in the top 200. You see more Singapore universities, for instance, in the top 200 from Korea, but still very relatively few. The large majority of universities are still American universities, followed by British universities. And in the top 10, there's only one European university which is not British, and that is ETH in Zurich. Still, Europe and the United States together are very dominant in the rankings. They basically are occupying the large part of the rankings around the world, followed a little bit by countries like Australia. Hong Kong is doing reasonably well, but then the rest is following. And Russian universities are relatively low percented in the rankings. That's why also the government has set up this initiative of 5100 to try to change that. But it is, as I said, it is very difficult. You have to focus it on a long-term investment in the quality of what you are doing. But what we see still, all over the world, rankings are so important that they define the agenda of the universities. They focus very much on output. So you see, like here in Russia, what are universities doing because of the 5100 project? They say, well, we have to teach in English. Because otherwise we will not get international students if we don't get international scholars, so we have to teach in English. But is that making sense? If you don't have enough quality of teachers and enough quality of local students to be able to do that. Otherwise you get very poor quality of teaching in English. Or you make it that the international students are sitting in one classroom and the local students in another classroom, because the one is taught in English and the other one is taught in Russian. That's not what you call internationalization. That's not bringing students and faculty together. So there is a high risk, and so we have to look very much more, not to be directed by the rankings and their indicators, but much more by the quality of what we're doing. So they have a strong impact, and we have to do that. Because of time, I will shift a little bit from that, the rankings, but rankings are very important. Are there questions or comments about rankings from your side? You all are aware that RUDN is in the 5100 project as one of the 15 universities in Russia that are getting funding from the government to increase their quality and by the excellence, and by that being hopefully in the future high in the rankings. There was a lot of discussion, as you understand, in this university. Should we do that? Should we try to change? There was a resistance to that, and that's also understandable to a certain extent, but at the same time, you have to innovate, you have to compete. So that's the challenge that universities are facing. As I said, the relationship between quality and internationalization is very important. Internationalization is not a goal in itself, but it's a means to enhance the quality of what we are doing. And it makes it important that international has to be embedded in the overall assessment of what your university is doing. You cannot set up a separate strategy for internationalization and the rest of the university is just going the traditional way. But you see that unfortunately happening. And there's not such a thing as an international university. You have different types of international dimensions. You have it always to address in your context. The same as international accreditation. A lot of universities say we want to be internationally accredited. There doesn't exist something like international accreditation. There is not a body somewhere in the world that says we are accrediting this university to be international. What you have is agencies, national agencies or professional agencies that accredit. But that is only recognized by that agency or by that accreditation agency at the national level, but it doesn't say anything about now you are internationally accredited. But it happens a lot, and even this morning we had a discussion about it. RUDN said, well, we are internationally accredited in so many programs and European accredited, that they are accredited by those agencies, but that doesn't mean that they are now international. So language here is important as well. If we talk about internationalization, we have three pillars. Mobility, partnerships, and curriculum. And mobility has to do with mobility of students, mobility of staff, mobility of programs. Partnerships is how you make that mobility and that cooperation possible. And curriculum has everything to do with the students and how they what they learn in their area. And research is related to all of that, but is not really strategic in internationalization of higher education. Research has its own dimension to be internationalized. But mostly when we talk about internationalization, we talk about these three pillars, and we talk about two components, internationalization abroad and internationalization at home. Abroad has everything to do with what I said about mobility. Yeah? Student degree mobility, and you go abroad for a full bachelor program, or a full master, or a full PhD, or a mixture of those two. Credit mobility is you are a student here at RUDN and you go for a semester abroad and you get credits there and you bring those credits back as part of your whole degree. We have short-term mobility for language training and summer programs, etc. That's another possibility. You have staff mobility and you have program mobility, franchises, branch campuses, etc. That is still, as I said, driving the agenda of internationalization, but you have a whole second category, and that is what we call internationalization at home. And that is, you have to internationalize the campus. Like for instance here, you have a lot of international visibility, not only by the fact that you have so many international students, but also you have everything in two languages indicated. You have international clubs and international bars and all those kind of things. So you have really an internationalized campus environment, which not many universities have. You have internationalization of the curriculum. I will give you a definition of that, what we mean with that. The whole teaching and learning environment, to have international classrooms, the international students are not separate but are integrated in the class, the faculty are integrated in the class. You have joint programs, double degree programs with universities abroad, or joint degree programs where your students take part of the courses in different universities. And you have intercultural and international competences and learning outcomes. So how do you make really the student competent to be able to live and work in a global environment? We use different terms to say that. So what is, and I will give them each, transnational and cross-border education has to do everything with mobility. And that's a very important part. I said already 5 million students are studying in another country than their home. But what is increasingly also happening is that more and more students are studying at home in a foreign university, which is a branch campus or a franchise operation or what you call an articulation program, all kinds of different models or joint and double degree programs. More and more students are getting their degree from a foreign university, which is based as a franchise or a branch campus or another program in their country. You have, for instance, in Qatar and Dubai in the Middle East, you have complete educational cities with branch campuses from American, English, French universities in Qatar. You have branch campuses in Vietnam, you have them in Singapore, you have them in Hong Kong, you have franchise operations everywhere, you have in China branch campuses, you have increasingly you have those kind of new models that are happening. So it is to do with everything which has to be mobile. That's the mobility side. But internationalization at home, we'll say it is the purposeful integration of international intercultural dimensions into the formal and informal curriculum for all students within domestic learning environments. That's a definition by two colleagues of mine of what is internationalization at home. So it forces the university to integrate international and intercultural dimensions in the curriculum. The formal curriculum, that is what you get in your classroom, that's within your syllabus and your study guide, but also in the informal curriculum, what you do outside of the classroom, what you do in international clubs, etc., and all those kind of activities. And that is for all students. And it is in your own institution, it's not by sending students abroad, but it's for all students. And that's a huge difference than when we talk about mobility. I said that mobility is an important factor in internationalization, but let's take Europe as an example. Europe, something like 20 to 25% of students in Europe are having at least a semester or a year abroad as an experience. That means that still 80%, 75 to 80% of the students don't have that as part of their study. And already that's a very luxurious situation, because in the United States it's less than 10% of students who go for at least for a semester abroad. In Latin America it is less than 1%. In Africa less than 0.5%. In Asia less than 2%. In Russia it's also not very high. So it means that in general around the world 90% of the students don't have an international experience. So the only way you can create an international experience is by doing it at home for them. And since globalization is so important, we have to invest much more in internationalization at home and the other definition, internationalization of the curriculum. That is the process of incorporating international, intercultural and global dimensions into the content of the curriculum. So what are you learning? What knowledge do you get? That knowledge is not only knowledge from a Russian background, but also from a European or a global background. That you learn what medicine or economics means in different contexts. That's very important, but it's also what learning outcomes you learn, what kind of intercultural competences you develop. How do you evaluate that intercultural competence? What kind of teaching methods do you use in the classroom? Do you incorporate the international students actively in the learning? What kind of support service do you have for your students to make them much more globally competent? These are all kind of dimensions that need a lot of attention. And even I would say in this university, although you have a very international classroom experience and you have an international student body, there is still a lot to do on internationalization of the curriculum. That still has to be driven. Another term that is used very much in that context is global citizenship. You see it more and more that in policy documents they say, well, the role of the university is to create global citizens. And it has two dimensions. One is we have to learn students to be able to work in a global environment, so they have to be professionals that can work in a global context. engineers that have increasingly have to work in international teams. Doctors, nurses, etc. have to deal with international diseases and disasters, etc. Everything is more and more international in your profession, so you have to learn that. But also, we have a role to society, and that society increasingly is also global. All the issues that we are addressing are global issues. Health, climate, poverty, all kind of issues that makes that we have to prepare as university students to be able to understand that those issues are global issues and that we have to work together to solve them. And we have to make them also actively aware that they have to pay a contribution later to that. So that's the double role of the universities in creating really global citizens. And by that, you have to do it in a comprehensive way. As a definition of what we call comprehensive internationalization, it is a commitment and action to infuse international, global, and comparative content perspectives to everything we do in teaching and research and service. It has to have ethical dimensions, so it has to be really an ethical issue. Increasingly with the commercialization in higher education, we see that there's a lot of corruption, there's a lot of fraud in higher education, also in the international context. We have to change that, we have to be ethical. And it has to impact everything we do, all aspects of the university, including our context with the rest of society. What does that mean for the definition of internationalization? This is a definition which my colleague Jay Knight, with whom I worked in the 1990s on the concept of internationalization for the OECD, and this definition quite generally accepted, is the process of integrating an international, intercultural, or global dimension into the purpose, functions, and delivery of post-secondary education. So it's an ongoing process. You cannot say this university is international because it has 25% of international students. No, you have to adapt it to the modern situation. You have to change, you have to innovate, you have to change that. It is international, intercultural, because there's also a strongly, increasingly intercultural dimension, and it has to deal with the globalization, so global dimensions as well. And it has to do with everything what we do, how we teach, how we do research, what our mission is, what our reputation is, everything has to be immersed in international. This is a quite commonly accepted definition, but at the same time, in the context of the European Parliament study that we did, we asked 185 experts around the world, what would you see for the future? Is this definition still addressing the needs that we need to have for higher education? And they said, well, we have to have internationalization be more inclusive and less elitist. We cannot have internationalization only meaning something for those 5 to 10 or 20% of the students and 5 or 10% of the faculty. We have to make internationalization available to all students. So it has to be not elitist. Mobility is still important, but it has to be integrated in the curriculum. It has not to be something that a few students do and nobody else cares about. It has to be part of your curriculum. So joint and double degree programs are very important. We have to re-emphasize that it's not a goal in itself, but in a means to enhance the quality. And we have to make clear that they cannot be driven only by profit, by economic rationales. So they created together a new definition, which is built on the one by Jay Knight that I showed before, but we added some words. First of all, we said that it has to be intentional. The process cannot be going in itself. Leaders of institutions, leaders of government have to really say, well, we want this process to happen. Like, for instance, now with the 5100 program, the government has said, well, we want universities to become more international. So it has to be intentional. And it has to be in order to enhance the quality of what we're doing. And it has to be for all students and staff, not only for the small percentage that is mobile. And we have to make a meaningful contribution to society, so that whole global citizenship dimension which I mentioned before. So this is what drives the agenda for internationalization very much for the future, according to those experts. And in the European Parliament, they were very supportive to that in their way how they want to address the programs for the European Commission in the future. What does it lead to, in our view? First of all, we see as desirable outcomes of internationalization a system of higher education capable of producing those global citizens and professionals. That we have to be having a higher education that is respectful and appreciative of other cultures, and that it not is inward looking, that we not see what is unfortunately all over the world currently happening, a much more populist, a nationalist, not global, international focus in the way of thinking of people. We have to be understanding that there are other cultures and that we have to cooperate and to work together and understand those other cultures. We have to be able to contribute to the development of knowledge economies, but also be socially inclusive, so not keep out the developing world, not keep out the emerging economies, not keep out the marginalized immigrants in the world. We have better position our higher education to address the global issues, the sustainable development goals of the United Nations, like health, poverty, climate, etc. We have to compete, we also have to cooperate. And we have to do that not only among the developed world, but also including the emerging regions and developing world as such. That's what really we want with internationalization. That should be driving much more the agenda than the commercial way which we have seen over the past decades. How can you do that? Make use of technological opportunities. Virtual exchange. We still think that we have to be able to meet other students and other faculty by going abroad, by having a semester abroad. But now, with technology, we can have international classrooms by internet. We can have students and faculty work together on the internet. We call that in the United States collaborative online international learning, so that students and faculty not only are sitting together in the classroom, but also are getting joint assignments, and that faculty together assess the assignments and discuss with the students. It makes it much more cheaper, it makes it much more accessible to a lot of students than just doing it by mobility. We have further to develop joint and double degree programs so that the mobility becomes an integral part of the curriculum. Because with a joint and double degree program, you have to be going to collaborate with other students, online or physically. You have to do, faculty have to work together, so that's another way. We have to mutually recognize our credits and degrees, still a big problem in many collaborations around the world. We have to enhance the qualitative indicators and quality assurance systems. So how do we, what does mean internationalization when you do accreditation processes? Greater commitment to equal partnerships. Partnerships among universities are in general still dominated by those who have the power, those who have the money, those who have the knowledge, and those who don't have, which creates a dominant dependency. And if we want to make an inclusive society, then we really have to respect that others have also knowledge, but maybe they don't have the money, but still the knowledge can be used as a kind of exchange for money. So equal partnerships is a very important thing for the future. Stronger fostering of public and private initiatives, increasingly working between NGOs and universities, companies and universities. The big trend for the future, if you talk about mobility, is not so much in study abroad, but internships abroad. Having a work experience in an international company or an international community, that's increasingly more important. Make research and education more together. Now it is compartmentalized in blocks. We have research funding, we have educational funding, but we don't see that they can strengthen each other. And we have to work much more on internationalizing all the levels of education. We still think that higher education can solve all the problems, but let's talk about English or other foreign languages. If you only have to start to learn a foreign language when you are in a university, you cannot use it very well. But if you improve the quality of foreign language teaching in primary and secondary education, that benefits immediately the way how you can internationalize higher education. The same with knowledge about geography, knowledge about history in the global context, and knowledge about intercultural communication. There are all kind of things that increasingly can be done in K-12 education as well. But we don't do that. We still look into the higher education. So there are ways how you can do that. There are of course barriers as well. And I end with that. Lack of funding is still an issue. So there has to be much more investment by governments and universities in making internationalization and global engagement possible. Bureaucratic obstacles, very big challenge. I mean, if I see how many signatures for my visit here I have to pay on papers, that is a lot of energy lost in absolutely non-useful ways of communication. You can do that in a much more effective way, but everywhere we see a lot of bureaucratic obstacles. We see different funding mechanisms, etc. We see the dominance of English, where we forget that other languages increasingly are more important. So we have to invest much more in foreign language training. Luckily enough, this university is a very good example of doing that. As I said, overdominance of mobility, no reward for faculty is another issue for being international in teaching and learning. Lack of integration of different policies at the institutional, national and supranational level, and the overdominance of rankings in driving the agenda of internationalization that are barriers. But there is a huge opportunity, and internationalization is the future. Although the political climate at the moment all over the world looks differently, there's no way we can escape from being connected and communicating, cooperating and competing internationally. That's unavoidable. Use that opportunity, and this university is an example of how you can do that by having a very strong international dimension in this policy. Thank you very much. So, still time for comments and questions. I mean, you cannot all agree with me, or you can still not have any questions or anything. Yes?
What are the chances of receiving a scholarship to study abroad in such a country
such as America? It varies by country. In general, there are not so many scholarship opportunities in most countries. The large majority of students who go abroad pay that by own funding of their families, or sometimes even, I know many examples in China, that sometimes even the whole village supports the student to go abroad. But there are countries that are having scholarships. Of course, we have scholarships like I mentioned for the European Commission for programs like Erasmus, etc. Is one example, but also countries like Brazil had a program, a very strong program, Science Without Borders, to send students for a semester or a year abroad with scholarship. Now, because of the political and economic situation in Brazil, that money is unfortunately drastically decreased. Countries like Saudi Arabia have strong scholarship programs for their students to go abroad. In a country like Norway has that opportunity for students. They say, well, we don't want to invest in too many universities because we are a very thin and long stretched country. So many of the students in Norway get a scholarship to go for a full degree abroad. But that varies very much by country, so there's not one country to give an example. In the United States, it's nearly impossible for getting national governments. You have the Fulbright program, but that's a very small program. So it is not very easy, and in general it's only addressed to the best and brightest students. You see a trend even in Russia when they have scholarships, they say we only give scholarships to students who are going to the top 100 ranked universities. So that makes it very difficult, because it's not very easy to get accepted in those universities. So there are unfortunately limitations to scholarships, you have to invest money with yourself, unfortunately, in most cases. But if you are a talented student, there are always opportunities. Yes?
I have the same question.
You have the same question. So everybody looks for scholarships. You all want to go abroad. Which is itself.
You came here to study. Huh? That's the university. You came here to do this. You came here to study.
Yeah.
That's our goal.
Yes, no, but that's very good. But yeah, but are you looking for scholarships to stay, to continue to stay here, or?
I think most of us are looking for a scholarship that will give us better education. No matter the fact that you stay somewhere, that you
work
somewhere abroad, or here in Russia.
Yeah. No, and I think in itself that's important. I mean, if my experience is, if you have the ambition to go abroad, and you really invest in it, also in the quality of what you're doing, and in looking for scholarships, there are opportunities. Not for everybody, but for the good students there and the motivated students. And motivation is sometimes even much better perceived than your quality. That's a very important aspect, because scholarship foundations and governments like to see motivated students to get an experience, because they think it pays back in the long run. So keep working on that as much as possible, but unfortunately there are less opportunities than there are interest by students to go abroad.
How the universities can improve their curriculum for international students? Which the best ways? How I can understand that this university, for me, like an international student, the best for me, which ways they must do? Which steps they must do?
To get more international students?
Yes, for more. No.
More acceptable for international students. Yeah. Well, there are many things what this university and other universities can do. First of all, they have to increasingly modernize the way they communicate with potential students. So internet is increasingly more important. So have a good website with a lot of clear information. Responding very quickly and adequately to students' requests for information or for admission procedures. If you have to fill in 25 forms in paper and send it by mail, etc., the student already goes to another website to find another opportunity. So be much more responsive to the social media approach that modern students have. Be also very clear that you have to give them good facilities, dormitories, that there's place in the dormitories and that they're of good quality. Be clear about what entrance requirements you have. Be clear about what opportunities you have for language training, for oral training, for sports facilities. So students are customers and they want to have good quality when they are here. So be investing a lot in the quality for the international students. At the same time, you have to avoid that the international students are getting much better facilities than the local students, because then the Russian students here would be very angry and say, well, we don't get the same kind of facility. So you have to invest for all students the good quality education, and then the international students will for sure come. Yes?
You talked about party of education, and can you explain more about party of education? What do you mean party of education? And is it important with international students or I think we need to know more about party of education. So can you
But for me, quality education means that the curriculum has to really do what students find important for their future careers, and careers and also their engagement with society. So that the curriculum is not something that is only focusing, in particular for international students, on local case studies, but really makes it understandable how the Russian context operates in the global context, so that the students can understand what is happening in the world and not only in Russia or in their own country. So content-wise, to understand much better what is happening in your discipline around the world, that's one thing. Second is quality education means also that you are much more focusing on the way you teach smaller groups, much more interactive groups, much more assignments, not a one-way direction of the teacher talking to the students, but in smaller groups working on joint projects, problem-based learning activities, all those kind of ways of how to improve the way of teaching are also very important. Using modern technology, using YouTube, MOOCs in the classroom, so online courses. Try to understand as faculty that the world is rapidly changing and the way of that students learn is also changing by that, and that you cannot have the classical one-way approach that we had for a long time. We were discussing this morning, and that's also what this university is actively trying to do. And that takes time, because the younger the faculty are much more able to do that and also willing to do that than the older faculty. And of course, you cannot just say bye-bye to the older faculty, because they also have to teach. So you have how to make it possible takes time, but you have to invest in that. And that's, I think, what good universities like this university increasingly do, is trying to modernize the way of teaching, trying to adapt it also to the way of thinking of the students and the way of thinking of employers, to make it much more adaptable. That, in my view, is how you can increase the quality of education. And for the international students, it means in particular also that they not only get a sense, which is also important, of the Russian way of learning, the Russian society and the Russian culture, but that also they get that in comparison to their own context, so that they can to be much more interculturally competent by interacting with the students, by interacting with the faculty, with interacting with the society around them. That's, for I think, for international students very important. Other questions or comments? Yes.
Do I understand correctly that in trying to bring forth internationalization, it will be best to minimalize quantitative aspects and increase the qualitative aspects of internationalization?
Well, I would not phrase it that way, but what I say is that the quality has to be the driving agenda. And that means not that you don't have quantity as a kind of indicator for it, but if the quantity becomes the driving agenda, then it can be going at the cost of quality. Let me give an example. You see now in the United States, a lot of universities in the countryside who have a demographic problem, that there are not enough local students. So what do? They recruit international students, and they mainly come from China. And then suddenly they have a class with 50% Chinese students and 50% American students. The Chinese students are getting poor quality education because their English is not good enough. The American students get also poor quality education because they cannot interact in the same classroom. That's then the quantity to get more students for income generation is driving in the wrong way the agenda. If you do it like here, you say certain targets, we want to have 25 to 40% international students, but we don't want to have a dominance of Chinese students or a dominance of students from Kazakhstan, which are the two largest groups here on this university, but we want to have a diverse international classroom, then you get more chances that you have an international classroom that is qualitative interactive. Then the Russian students are still a high number, but they're not compensated by another high number of other students from one group. So quantity is an indicator, but it's not, should not be driving the agenda, but you cannot avoid data, because quantitative data you always have. But making it diverse is very important.
The reason why I'm asking is because I'm wondering if your your research or your center looks at the cultural barriers. Because even if you have that integrated class, yeah, you have the situation where the method of teaching may not be conducive to the Russians, but maybe to the international students. And yes, the international students are becoming maybe assimilated into the culture, etc. But the Russian students, they're not understanding what's being taught because that's not their method. So how does your research overcome cultural barriers?
Well, the only way you can do that is by training the faculty to understand that you have to deal with this kind of different cultural values. Your example is a very clear example. We see that a lot also with Asian students, which have a tendency when they go to the United States or to Europe, that that way they still have a kind of old tradition. They have to listen to the teacher, and they are not very interactive. And the teacher then think they are dumb because they don't speak. The students also are very much not aware about, of afraid about speaking out, but they are much more clever than they show. If the teacher is not aware about those cultural differences, then the teaching will be always poor quality, because then either you address only the international students and not the Russian students, or you only address the local students and not the Chinese students or whatever. So you have to really train the faculty and what it means to teach in an international classroom and how to understand that there are those kind of differences, differences in cultural, differences in language capacity, and how to make that work in the classroom by paying attention to those different issues. I had a case in my own teaching that we had two students from Korea and five American students, and I asked the American students to talk with the Korean students about how to integrate international students in the classroom. And the other American students, they were sitting and watching with me, and the five students, two Korean students sitting in the group and discussing that. And what happened, the five American students were talking about how to integrate the Korean students, and the Korean students didn't say anything because they had no chance to interfere because their English was not good enough to say something. And the American students didn't see that, only the outside students and I did see what was happening. So. And we have a lot of those kind of experiments to make clear how complicated that issue is. But if you don't address it, then you never get the quality education that you need. So train the faculty, make them aware about that teaching in an international classroom is something completely different than teaching only in a local classroom. That is a very important way of how to improve that. But it is not easy, that's for sure. It's a good question, because we know that indeed international students in many cases when they go abroad, certainly in the first semester, have a lot of psychological problems to adapt, and they feel uncomfortable because they are not in contact with the local society, they have problems with the language, they don't understand the way teaching is taking place, they don't understand sometimes even the food and everything is different. So you really have to invest as a university, in particular in the first semester, a lot in making, for instance, buddies. I don't know if they do that here, but in many universities they say, well, an international student gets a local buddy student, and they are, during the semester, of help to the student by not only help, but also try to become friends, if it works. And by that, making it much more integrated, so that they're not feeling isolated. If you do it in other ways, then the international students everywhere have a tendency to click together. And in particular, larger groups than in those international students also click together. So if you then are, let's say, a student from Ivory Coast in Africa, and you're the only Ivory Coast student, and you are in a whole group with Kazakhstan students and Chinese students, you're also not in the grade with them. So you have to do something by making it possible for those students to also feel at home, and that you have to invest in those kind of issues. So that's buddy systems in general work the best way to make that happen. Okay, no further, yes?
What do you think about our chances, about the chances of Russian universities, and particularly our university, to achieve a top 100?
You want an honest answer? I don't think that it will be happening, to be quite, not in 2020. I will not exclude that it might happen in 2030 or 2040, but I think it will be unrealistic for a Russian university to come into the top 100 in 2020, which doesn't mean that in itself the investment in increasing the quality of the Russian universities is a bad investment. It helps to improve the quality of what you are doing. So in that sense, the money is not best spent. I mean, I don't have all the details about how all the money is spent, but I still think excellence programs like also Germany, etc., do have very good programs to increase the quality of at least your top universities. But reaching the top 100, that will be very difficult for even for the top universities like the Lomonosov University. That will be very difficult. Top 200 would be already very nice for one of them. But again, it is important that you have a diverse system of higher education, where you have some top world-class universities, and Russia in the future will get there, and the investment in that sense will be very good.
Thank you.